So here we can see the anterior abdominal wall. So before beginning with the incisions and all, first a brief overview of the anterior abdominal wall. In general, as we know, the anterior abdominal wall is divided into 9 quadrants. So which are the planes which divide these quadrants? So the two vertical planes, those are parallel to the midpoint of the clavicle. So that is the midclavicular line on each side. So there are two midclavicular lines. And two horizontal lines are there. One horizontal line is transpyloric plane, that's at the level of the pylorus, that's at the vertebral level L1 level. Okay, and there is one more horizontal plane, that is the transtubercular plane, that is at the vertebral level L5. Okay, so by this two horizontal plane and two vertical plane, the abdomen is divided into 9 quadrants. So which are those 9 quadrants? On each side there is two hypochondriac region, right and the left hypochondriac. And there is epigastric region, and surrounding the umbilicus is umbilical region. Then on each side there is on each side of the umbilical region there is right and the left lumbar region, and in the lower part there is right and the left iliac region. Okay, so these 9 quadrants are important because there are underlying organs which are there. So as per the patient's complaint, one can predict the organ of pathology from the region of the pain in the anterior abdominal wall. Okay, and the few clinical things here, one region is referred to as the McBurney's point. When we connect this umbilicus to the anterior superior iliac spine, the junction between the medial 2/3 and the lateral 1/3, this point is referred to as the McBurney's point. It is the region where pain of appendicitis is most commonly felt. So actually the base of the appendix, it lies underneath this region. So pain and tenderness of appendicitis is felt in this region. Okay, and in the anterior abdominal wall, on the lateral margin of the rectus abdominis, there is a line referred to as the linea semilunaris. Okay, when we trace this linea semilunaris upwards, when it cuts the costal margin, it actually cuts at the level of the tip of the 9th costal cartilage. This point is referred to as Murphy's point, where pain of gallbladder stones or cholecystitis is most frequently felt. Okay, so these two clinical points we need to know in the anterior abdominal wall. And other surface landmarks, if you see, one is the costal margin, linea alba, umbilicus. Linea alba will be traced downwards, here is the pubic symphysis, then there is pubic crest, pubic tubercle. Okay, all these are the important surface landmarks. Okay, and for the layer-wise dissection, first we have cut through the linea alba. Okay, and from the Zipi sternum, I have taken a horizontal incision on each side. Okay, so now we are reflecting the skin of the anterior abdominal wall. Okay, here we can see only the skin part is removed. Just beneath the skin, there is superficial fascia which is still there that I will reflect now. So this layer which we can see, this is the superficial fascia. Okay, just beneath the skin is superficial fascia. And superficial fascia, if we try to feel it, in the upper part it is thin and in the lower part it is thick. Why? Because below the umbilicus there are two layers of superficial fascia. Okay, superficial fatty layer is referred to as camper's fascia, and there is a deep membranous layer that is referred to as scarpa's fascia. Okay, so this is the superficial fascia that I have reflected now. Just beneath this superficial fascia, now we will see the muscles of the anterior abdominal wall. Okay, so which all are the muscles in anterior abdominal wall? There are three muscles from outside to inside. And we see the lateral aspect of the anterior abdominal wall. One is external oblique, and there is internal oblique, and below it is transversus abdominis. Okay, so these are the three muscles, and there are two vertical muscles as well. One is rectus abdominis muscle. There is one vertical muscle that is referred to as pyramidalis muscle. It's a small degenerating muscle seen in the lower part. This one is pyramidalis muscle. Okay, so there are 5 muscles on each side: external oblique, internal oblique, transverse abdominis. I didn't show you. I'll show you on the other side. So for that, I have reflected this anterior abdominal wall. From the inner side, the horizontal fibers which we can see, these are nothing but transversus abdominis muscle. Okay, so we have identified the muscle. Let's have a brief overview of these muscles. External oblique muscle, as we know, it arises from the lower 8 ribs. Okay, on the outer aspect of the lower 8 ribs, it runs obliquely downwards and in the lower aspect it turns, upturns, and it forms the inguinal ligament, and its insertion it goes here on the outer aspect of the iliac crest. You all have read about the hip bone, right? On the upper margin of the iliac crest there are three muscles from outside to inside. The outermost aspect is external oblique. So for external oblique it is insertion of the muscle, whereas other two muscles, internal oblique and transversus abdominis, those two muscles arise from the iliac crest, okay? And distal attachment or insertion, if we see, for external oblique it is on this xiphoid process, then the linea alba, then the pubic symphysis, then pubic crest, pectineal line. So these structures are common insertions for external oblique, internal oblique, as well as transversus abdominis. Okay, only one difference is external oblique is coming from the upper part, and internal oblique and transverse abdominis, they are coming from the lower part going upwards, and their distal attachment is again coming towards this linea alba. Why? Because aponeurosis of these structures form the wall of the rectus sheath. Okay, so they cross from one side to the other side, and in the midline they meet. Okay, so this was about external oblique. Internal oblique, it is arising from the iliac crest as well as from the inguinal ligament. Here you can see some white fibers. So internal oblique origin from the lateral aspect of the inguinal ligament as well, and as well as from the iliac crest. Okay, running obliquely upwards and medially, and distal attachment or insertion is on the, again, xiphoid process, linea alba, the pubic crest, pectineal line. So all those are included in insertion. Similarly for the transversus abdominis muscle, for here proximal attachment or origin is also from a layer of the back, that is the thoracolumbar fascia. Okay, from the thoracolumbar fascia also there is origin of this transversus abdominis muscle. Okay, now let's look at the rectus sheath. Rectus sheath is formed by aponeurosis of these muscles, and to clearly know the various structures forming the rectus sheath, we have to divide the anterior abdominal wall into three regions. One is the region up to the costal margin, and one region is up from the costal margin up to the arcuate line. So for arcuate line, we'll have to see the posterior aspect of the rectus sheath. Here we can see this margin here. Okay, this margin is the arcuate line. See, we can see this inferior epigastric vessels coming inside the rectus sheath, passing through this, passing in front of this arcuate line. Okay, so this one is the arcuate line. So one region is from costal margin to the arcuate line, and beyond arcuate line is the third region. Okay, so three regions, the three different structures form the wall of the rectus sheath. The anterior wall of rectus sheath above the costal margin is formed by aponeurosis of external oblique. Okay, and from costal margin to the arcuate line, anterior wall is formed by external oblique as well as anterior lamina of the internal oblique. Okay, you can see this external oblique, internal oblique, anterior lamina is also forming anterior wall. Okay, and beyond this costal margin, anterior wall is formed by external oblique, internal oblique, as well as transversus abdominis. Okay, all three muscles, fibers, aponeurosis, they come and form the anterior wall in the lower third. Okay, now let's look at the posterior wall of the rectus sheath. This one is the posterior wall. So we can see this rectus abdominis muscle is resting directly on this ribs and the costal cartilages above the costal margin. Okay, so posterior wall is formed by the lower 5, 6, 5th, 6th and the 7th ribs and the costal cartilages above the costal margin. And from costal margin to the arcuate line, here the posterior wall is formed by posterior lamina of the internal oblique as well as aponeurosis of transversus abdominis. And beyond that there will be fascia transversalis as well. Okay, and when we see the part below this arcuate line, posterior wall is deficient. And now this rectus abdominis muscle is resting directly on this fascia transversalis. Okay, so this was about anterior wall and posterior wall of the rectus sheath. And what about contents of rectus sheath? One muscle in the content, rectus abdominis is the chief content. This pyramidalis muscle is also one of the content. So two muscles are there in the content, and two sets of blood vessels, inferior epigastric artery and vein. Similarly, superior epigastric artery and vein. Okay, and the lower six thoracic spinal nerves, they enter the rectus sheath through the lateral aspect. Here we can see these nerves. Okay, anterior abdominal wall is not supplied by all nerves of the abdomen. It is actually the lower six thoracic nerves which supply the anterior abdominal wall. Okay, so those nerves we are giving it, they are entering the rectus sheath from the lateral aspect. This is surgically important because whenever surgical approach has to be done, we have to approach from the midline or close to the midline. Okay, if we try to approach it from the lateral aspect, we may injure these nerves. Okay, and these nerves also supply the other muscles, the external oblique, internal oblique, transverse abdominis. All these muscles are supplied by this lower six thoracic nerve. Okay, and also the first lumbar nerve that also contributes to the nerve supply of these muscles. Okay, so this was about the rectus sheath. So for the rectus sheath, anterior wall, posterior wall, its contents, everything is important. Okay, now let's cover the inguinal canal. So for the inguinal canal, first we have identified the spermatic cord. So just trace the spermatic cord upwards, we will appreciate an opening. So that opening is actually the superficial inguinal ring, and that opening is in the aponeurosis of this external oblique muscle. Okay, this is the external oblique muscle. So this opening is the superficial inguinal ring. Okay, and the landmark for it is pubic tubercle. Okay, to identify the pubic tubercle, just go above and medial to the pubic tubercle, we reach the superficial inguinal ring. So inguinal canal has got this superficial inguinal ring. Similarly, on the inner aspect there is deep inguinal ring, and there are further tunnel-like structure forms the boundaries of the inguinal canal. Okay, so we'll see all that. So one opening we have seen, this is the superficial inguinal ring. For the other opening, we have just looked at the other side of the dissection. This is the anterior abdominal wall. We have reflected it, and now we are viewing it from the inferior aspect. This opening which we can see here, now I am putting the forceps here. Okay, this opening is the deep inguinal ring. Okay, how we can identify that this is deep? So for that, here also we have identified the spermatic cord. So I will just pull this spermatic cord and just appreciate the structures which are entering or leaving this deep inguinal ring. Okay, so can you appreciate the structures are moving? Okay, which are these structures? This is ductus deferens, a thick cord like structure one can feel. Okay, as well as testicular artery which is entering, and pampiniform plexus of veins which is exiting from this deep inguinal ring. Okay, here the coverings of the spermatic cord are not seen. Why? Because as this muscles of the anterior abdominal wall, they go down, they form the covering of these structures, and that ultimately forms the spermatic cord. Okay, the external oblique muscle is there, that forms the external spermatic fascia. Then premastric fascia is formed by internal oblique as well as transversus abdominis. Okay, those two structures form the premastric fascia, and the fascia transversalis itself also goes inside, and that forms the internal spermatic fascia. Okay, that's why coverings are not seen here, only the structures are seen here. Okay, so this is the deep inguinal ring, and with the covering together, it is referred to as the spermatic cord. Okay, and what is the landmark for this deep inguinal ring? It is 1.25 centimeters above the mid inguinal point. Okay, somewhere here is the mid inguinal point, you can imagine, right? From the pubic symphysis to the anterior superior iliac spine midpoint, here is referred to as the mid inguinal point. Imagine 1.25 centimeters above it, and in this region, on the inner aspect, we are giving this deep inguinal ring. Okay, and there is one more landmark, is the inferior epigastric vessels. The deep inguinal ring is lateral to this inferior epigastric vessels. Okay, you can imagine it in anatomical position, this region is lateral to this inferior epigastric vessels. Okay, the hernia which is lateral to it is referred to as indirect inguinal hernia, and hernia medial to this inferior epigastric vessels is direct inguinal hernia. Okay, this was about the superficial and the deep inguinal ring. And what about the walls of the inguinal canal? Structure forming. So for that, let's look at this side. The anterior wall is formed by, so you can imagine there will be skin, superficial fascia, as well as this external oblique aponeurosis in its entire extent. Okay, and as well as this internal oblique muscle, it's coming in the anterior wall in the lateral aspect of the inguinal canal. Okay, so external oblique in its entire extent, and internal oblique in its lateral part forms the anterior wall of the inguinal canal. Now just extend this internal oblique, just below it is transverse abdominis. Okay, those two muscle fibers will fuse together and they will form the roof of the inguinal canal here. Okay, and those fibers, which then they go behind. So together they are referred to as conjoint tendon. Okay, so conjoint tendon forms the posterior wall of the inguinal canal. Okay, so I'll repeat again, anterior wall is formed by external oblique aponeurosis as well as internal oblique in the lateral part. Roof is formed by internal oblique as well as transversus abdominis. Posterior wall will be formed by conjoint tendon, which is nothing but fusion of this internal oblique and transversus abdominis. And floor is formed by this inguinal ligament. This white fiber, which you can see, inguinal ligament is nothing but the upturned portion of this external oblique aponeurosis. Okay, so upper grooved portion of the inguinal ligament, it forms the floor of the inguinal canal. Okay, so for the inguinal canal, its openings, the superficial inguinal ring, deep ring, its boundaries, and the hernia related to it, the direct and the indirect inguinal hernia, all these are important. So this was all about the anterior abdominal wall, rectus sheath, and the inguinal canal. Thank you.